Hi everyone, how are you doing? I'm Saoga News. This is Global Trends course for new Abyssinia College students. And in our last time class, we started chapter two, which is about foreign policy and diplomacy. And we define foreign policy. We define also what are the objectives of foreign policy. We saw national interest and the three types of, or three different objectives of foreign policy, which is a short-term objective, middle-term objectives, and long-term objectives of foreign policy. Today, we start from foreign policy behaviors, and this behaviors contains what is foreign policy pattern and foreign policy trends. Foreign policy, when we start from the definition, foreign policy behavior refers to action states take towards the other country, the actions of one country toward the other country, and that action shows the foreign policy behaviors of the country. This action have large purpose to fulfill long-term interests and short-term interests of the other country. And according to Roland Wolfers, he suggested that all foreign policy behaviors can be boiled down to three possible patterns. He said foreign policy has three different patterns. The first pattern is self-preservation pattern, the other is self-extension and self-abrogation. When you see self-preservation, this means working to maintain the status quo of the present international system. And this is the pattern followed by mostly countries who like the present international relation system, or countries when they like the present international relation, they work to preserve that one. And for example, United States of America, who is developer of the present international system, works to preserve the system and the status quo. The second pattern, which is self-extension, they work to revise the status quo in their own favor. That means these types of pattern show that the countries doesn't like the present status quo or the present structure, and the workers to change that one. And countries like China are known by that. The workers to change the present international relation patterns. The other is self-abrogation, which is mainly a pattern followed by least developed countries. And they don't have the power or the capacity to change or to preserve the present system. So what they do is they work on the favors of the other third country. Or they work for the United States of America to preserve the system, or they work for China and other states to change the pattern. So according to Wolfers, the patterns of international or the patterns of foreign policy or the international relations system we are living can be boiled down into these three subdivisions. The other is foreign policy dimension. The other behaviors is foreign policy dimensions. The analysis of foreign policy can be done along a number of specific dimensions. That means we can see from different dimensions. When we see these dimensions, there are three different types of dimensions, which is the behaviors of a foreign policy. The first dimension is alignment. And this is where national leaders to choose to ally with certain country or to remain neutral. When you see alignment, the alignment dimension, countries might want to ally with other country, or they might want to be neutral. A country's alignment behavior can be vary from time to time, and it is not a constant process. When they want to alliance, that means they form agreement to provide mutual assistance. That can be military or economic assistance, and they carry legal weight and certain benefits and also risks from this alliance, for example, interference from other countries. This is the first dimension, alliance. The other one is neutrality. In the stance of formal or non-partisan world affairs, countries can want neutrality. Or neutrality is a stance of formal or non-formal partnership in the worlds of affair. That means countries keep low profile, neutral, and avoid problems of alliance. Neutral means they don't support any one of the different blocks in the world. The third dimensions of this alignment is non-alignment. And it has been the foreign policy patterns of most developed countries, developing states, not siding with either of the East or the West bloc during the Cold War. And now this non-alignment movement is not that much an active movement. So when we see alignment, countries might want to be enter into a formal alliance, that means a written alliance. The other one is neutrality, that means unwritten alliance. There will not be any formal written alliance. And the third one is non-alignment, that means not supporting any of the different blocks. The second dimension is scope. A second foreign policy dimension is the scopes of a country's activity and interest. Scope is how much activities a country will cover in its international relation. Same in this instance, some countries might have extensive or far-reaching international contact, while other countries have more limited activities. So in terms of this scope, countries can act as a global term, a regional term, or they might want isolation from the international system. When they act a global term, that means their action affects the whole countries. And this is mainly the scope covered by big countries, developed countries like USA, China, and other big countries like Germany. And when they act, they affect the whole world, and the scopes of their foreign policy is very wide, and it is developed into global terms. The other regional terms, and these are countries who have strong ties only on their regions. For example, if we take Ethiopia, it is an active actor in the Horn of Africa. Horn of Africa means it is a region which includes Somalia, Djibouti, Eritrea, Sudan, Uganda, and Kenya. And in this Horn of Africa region, Ethiopia is one of the active actors. So when your foreign policy is directed toward this, having a good relationship or influencing this region, scope is regional. The third scope is isolationism. That means just keeping your own affair and not having any relationship with the other parts of the world. And this is when a country limits its interaction with the external world. And in this time, this type of scope is no longer existed. For example, there was only a few countries in the world who have followed these types of international relations, and that no more exists at this time. And the third dimensions of a foreign policy dimension behavior is mode of oppression. There are patterns of foreign policy behavior on the basis of these methods of oppression. And this is two. The first one is when countries rely on multinational relations or multinational institutions to solve their problem, or when they depend on themselves to solve the problems. Some countries rely on multinational relations institutions to address different issues, while others choose to solve their problem by themselves. The more the multilateralist state is, the greater the tendency to seek solutions to problems through diplomatic forum in which several states participate, such as the United States, when a country is a multilateralist, they mostly use the United Nations or other forums to solve their problem. And most developing countries use multilateral approach because it is very difficult for them to influence other countries by themselves. On the other hand, countries may also rely on unilateral means of settling issues with other countries that these countries mostly have economic and military powers or muscles. When they are strong, they mostly use a unilateral approach. The others use the multilateral. So based on the modes of operation for the foreign policy of a country can use multilateral institutions or it can use itself unilaterally to solve its problem. The other issue we'll cover is the instruments of foreign policy. So we said foreign policy is a goal or a target that enables us to fulfill our national interests. So to fulfill those goals and national interests, we use different instruments. And one of the main instruments is diplomacy. And diplomacy, I think you all hear about diplomats or embassies or words like that. And this existed for a very long time. And it is diplomacy is a system of structured communication between two or more parties. That means that when they create structured institutions or structured communication, we call them, they have a diplomatic relationship. When we define diplomacy, it is a process between actors, that means diplomats usually representing the states. It is a process between actors who exist within the systems of the international relation, engage in private and public dialogue to pursue their objective in a peaceful manner. That means when they engage into a dialogue to solve their problem in a peaceful manner. For example, by this time you hear about the negotiation between Ethiopia and Egypt about the Great Ethiopian Renaissance Dam. That means they are represented by their diplomats and they are trying to solve their problem peacefully, and we call it diplomacy. So when we see the history of diplomacy, envoys traveling between neighboring countries dates back to 2,500 years. That means it has a very long history. And the main benefits of diplomacy is to promote exchange that enhances this exchange of diplomacy, exchanges, enhances trade, culture, wealth, and knowledge. This makes diplomacy an essential tool required to operate successfully in the international system. So in this time, if a country wants to become an active participant in the international system, it should have a well-developed diplomatic relationship with countries. So diplomacy is a complex game of maneuver in which the goal is to influence the behaviors of others in one's interest. So we said the negotiation between Ethiopia and Egypt on the dam is diplomacy. So why they negotiate is to influence one another. So Ethiopia wants to influence Egypt and wants to complete the dam and fill the waters of the dam in a short years, whereas Egypt wants that period of filling the dam long or more than 10 years. And they sit into a diplomatic table and negotiate to solve this problem. So this means diplomacy is a bargaining process among diplomats or leaders. So these leaders sit and bargain to get a better term. And bargaining can be defined as setting differences over priorities between parties through an exchange of proposal for mutual acceptance of solutions. The exchange proposals. One country puts the proposal that says this dam should be filled in 5 years. and the other come up with a proposal. It says, no, this dam should be filled in 15 years. So they negotiate to solve that problem, and we call that process a bargaining. Like any foreign policy instrument, diplomatic bargaining processes any elements of power or influence. If, when you put that terms on the table and the ability to influence the other country and fulfill your interest is mostly dependent on your power. So diplomacy is transformed in recent times and added multilateral diplomacy in country-to-country diplomacy. In the old time, most of these diplomacies have been made between one country and the other. But this time, there is an additional type of diplomacy, which is multilateral diplomacy, which includes many countries. For example, in the negotiation between Ethiopia and Egypt over the dam, there was a participation of African Union, there was a participation of European Union, even the Security Council, that means the body of the United Nations, that created a multilateral types of diplomacy. And we regard diplomacy as something that is being conducted for the most part between states. Even if there is a multilateral actor, diplomacy are mostly made among the states. And there is an international law that governs this diplomacy, and it is called Vienna Conventions of Diplomatic Relations. So any diplomatic process or any diplomatic issue will be governed by this convention. And yet the modern international system always involves powerful actors that are not a state. We say the states are the main participants of the diplomatic process, but this time there are international organizations like United Nations, World Bank, which affects negotiation. For example, in the negotiation between Ethiopia and Egypt, there was World Bank, which came as a negotiator or a mediator between the two parties, and they affected the process very much. So in our time, there were successful issues solved by diplomacy. There are a lot of negotiation and diplomatic relationship among countries, and it solved many problems in the world. And one of the big issues solved by diplomacy is the nuclear agreement between United States and USSR. That means Russia. The agreement between United States and Russia is one of the big issues solved by diplomacy in our world. So if you want to be successful in diplomacy, there are rules that need to be followed to fulfill your interest. The first rule is to be realistic. And it is important to have a goal that match your ability to achieve them. When you go to negotiation in a diplomatic table, the goal should be in your ability. So if the goal is very big compared with the country's economic and military ability, it will not be fulfilled. The second rule is be careful about what you say. And diplomacy, as we said, is a peaceful process, and it is what you say, or it is the words you use, what matters in the outcomes of the diplomatic process. That means you need to be careful on the words you are using in the process. The third rule is understanding the other side. For example, in the negotiation between Ethiopia and Egypt, if you are a negotiator, you need to understand what the other party, that means what the Egyptian wants from the process. If you understand what they want, it will be simple to develop your proposal. The other is taking common ground. As we said, to solve a problem through diplomatically, two countries should agree on the terms. If one country says the dam should be filled in 5 years, and the other says the dam should be filled in 15 years, there should be a common ground to solve those problems, like 10 years or 9 years or 11 years. The other is be patient. Diplomacy takes time. So the process takes a very long time. For example, the negotiation between Ethiopia and Egypt, it is taking almost 10 years since the start of the project. They are negotiating for, they are negotiating for the last 10 years, and diplomacy, this shows diplomacy takes time. And the others leave a venue for retreat, op- this leave the avenue of retreat open. That means when you put your proposal, it shouldn't, it should have any open space to retreat. That means if you want to agree on 10 years, your proposal shouldn't say 10 years. Where the proposal you need bring should say 4 years and 10 years. That means it will help you to have a space. So in general, states make considerable use of what is known as a carrot and stick approach when they rely on such diplomatic treat, diplomatic tactics, such as treaties, punishment, promise, and reward. The main instrument in the diplomatic relation is the economic instrument. We call it economic instruments of foreign policy. And this can be used to achieve foreign policy objectives of a state. If your economy is very strong and if you have economic relationship with the other country, you can use that one as an instrument to fulfill your interest from your diplomacy. There is hardly exists a state that is self-sufficient, and there is considerable degree of dependency among a dependency on trade among states. There is a lot of international trade, and no country produces all it, the product needed by its peoples. So all the countries importer and all the countries exporter. And this relationship can be used to fulfill your diplomatic objective or your foreign policy objective. So some of the instruments, economic instruments, are tariff, quota, boycott, embargo, and aid. And according to Holistic, states that economic, that economy, particularly trade instruments of foreign policy, are normally used for three purposes. We use these economic instruments to fulfill these three purposes. One is to achieve any foreign policy objective by exploiting need and dependency. When a country is dependent, by exploiting those dependencies, you can achieve your foreign policy. The other is to increase states' capability to or to deprive for potential enemies' capability. You can affect or improve or deprive the capability of the other state. And the third is to create guaranteed market and resource for supply or help maintain political obedience. So you can give access for market, and by giving that market access or by prohibiting that market access, you can achieve your foreign policy objective. And these are the three purposes. And when we see the instruments one by one, the first instrument is tariff. And tariff is a tax on imported products. When you import anything from to Ethiopia, for example, if you are importing clothes from Dubai or television or other instruments, there is tax. That tax is called tariff. And by increasing and decreasing this tariff, you can fulfill your diplomatic objective. You can put additional tax for products who are coming from some specific countries. The other is quota, and quota, it is a quantitative restriction on imported product. The first one is tariff, means adding tax on the product who are importing this country. The second one is quota, that means prohibiting import or putting a quantitative restriction on the imported product. For example, when there is an import, there is a negotiation, as I said, between Egypt and Ethiopia. If Ethiopia wants to influence Egypt, it can put quotas. That means we import only this amount of quantity from Egypt. So by putting that quota, it can influence the outcomes of the negotiation. The other is using boycott. This is a trade boycott organized by government that eliminates the import of either a specific commodity or total range of exported product by the country. Boycott is that means totally closing the markets of a country for products coming from the other country. For example, Ethiopia closes all the products or prohibits imports of any product from Egypt, that is called boycott. The other is embargo. It is a government that takes to deprive other countries of goods prohibited export of. That means it is just prohibiting export of product to the other country. That is called embargo. That means if Ethiopia prohibits all export to Egypt, that is called embargo. The other instrument is foreign aid. It is a transfer of money. Foreign aid is a transfer of money, good or technical advice from donors to recipients. And it is one of the main instruments in the international or in the foreign policy. For example, USA gives a lot of aid for Ethiopia and for many other developing countries. But when they are giving those aids are not for free. That helps them to fulfill their foreign policy objectives on those countries. And those foreign policy objectives are criteria to get those aids. The other is military support or military aid. It is probably the oldest types of aid which has been used for alliance. Military aid is mostly used to create an alliance among countries, and that affects or that used to fulfill your foreign policy objective. The other is loan, credit, and currency manipulation. This is also another instrument or economic instrument to fulfill foreign policy. In international relation, every aid and military help is made to by calculating the foreign policy of donor countries. That means no country gives money for free. When they are giving the money, they are calculating the benefit they are getting from that aid. And so countries should understand the motive before they accept help. If they are accepting military and other types of financial aid from other countries, from developed countries, they need to calculate the cost and the benefit. These are the economic instruments of, or the instruments that used to fulfill foreign policy of the country. At the country, Ethiopia has its own foreign policy. And these foreign policies are different among different times or different regions, we can say regions. And in this part, we will see or the overviews of foreign policies of Ethiopia in different times. That means we will cover the 150 years foreign policy of the country. As a country, Ethiopia has more than 3,000 years of civilization, but modern foreign policy started in the 19th century. That means with the Emperor Theodosius II. And this part is most of a historical part. We covered Theodros, Minilik, Haile Selassie, Dirk, and the EPRDF, and they all have a different types of foreign policy. So after defeating the regional lords, Theodros introduced the idea of modernity and modern army of the time. And he's the first to start the modernizations of the country. Theodros tried to develop a dynamic foreign policy that reaches out beyond the Horn region. And the foreign policy of Theodros was a very wide and dynamic foreign policy. And in his foreign policy, he started by making Western Christian countries as his allies in his foreign policy or in his international relation, and make Turkey, Egypt, and the other Arab countries as enemies. Because by those time, Ethiopia was surrounded by Egypt in the north, Turkey in the east, in the west, there was England, and also in the south, there is England and other countries who are trying to colonize those countries. And in his foreign policy, he started by making the Western countries, like that means the British, the France, the Italians, and others as friends of a country. So the emperor attempted to stabilize his diplomatic relation to fight his immediate enemies, claiming Christianity as instruments of foreign policy. That means the main goals of his foreign policy was to fight the Egyptian and the Turkish, the Turks. By this time, Turk was controlling the Red Sea and the whole region, and Egypt was trying to conquer the country and conquer the Nile. So his main goal was to fight those countries. He wants to use Christianity as instrument to create an alliance with Western countries. However, the emperor's passionate demand for modern technology and skilled manpower from Britain was not concluded to his satisfaction. So by making these Western countries as a friend, he asked the Britons to send him peoples who can construct modern weapons so that he can use to defeat his immediate problems or immediate powers, that is Turkish and Egypt. And that makes him angry, and he make a desperate actions of hostage taking. He took all the British missionaries and all the foreigners as a hostage to get a modern weapon from Britain. And that resulted a war between British army and Theodros. That means he started the British as the main friends of his international relation, but sadly they became the biggest problems of him. And even they went for war, and it is called the battle. It was done in the battles of Magdala, and he was defeated. And to escape the capture from the British, he made a suicide by that time, and his reign becomes very short. And when we see his calculations was wrong. The second ruler, that means who comes after Theodros, was Johannes. And like Theodros, Johannes considered Islam as a threat to the territorial integrity of the country. So for Theodros, his main problems was Egypt and Turkey. And to solve the problem, he calculated to use British and other Western countries. For Johannes, he put the problem in terms of Islam. Islam is the main problem for Ethiopia. He started from there and ended in his calculations was a bit closer to the reality. That means Egypt tried to put a serious security threat in his time, and Egypt invaded Ethiopia 2 times, and there was a war in 1875 and 1876 at the battles of Gundet and Kura. In those 2 wars, he successfully defended the country by defeating the Egyptians. In addition, the empire saw European expansionists as a great threat to the survivors of the country. So here it is, the difference between Theodros and Johannes. Theodros started as European powers like Britain and France as friends for the country. And he suffered because of that. But when Johannes comes, he also added them as a problem. He added that in times of Theodros, Egypt and Turkey was the main problem. But in times of Johannes, in addition to Egypt and Turkey, the other European countries also became the other problem. And the threat has turned out to be real, as Italy got foothold at the ports of Mitsuwa in 1885. That means Italy conquered Mitsuwa in 1885. However, the emperor died fighting with the Mahdists. So he also suffered and lost his power in a way which wasn't calculated by him. And the Mahdists are the militant groups in Sudan, and they were fighting with the Egyptians, and the England. And Johannes helped the England or the British in Sudan, and that makes the Mahdists angry. So because they became angry by his action, they conquered the western parts of the country, and there was a war between them. And unfortunately, Johannes died in those war with his countries. The third is the foreign policy during Minilik. That is the third after Theodros and Johannes. Following the death of Johannes, Minilik, the second of Shoa, has assumed to be the throne. He became the king, and he expanded his sphere of influence towards far south and east, incorporating the new areas and communities peacefully and in war. And he expanded his region to the south, to the east, and to the west, and created the present country. According to many Ethiopian historians, the southward expansion policy of the king was mainly targeted to have access to seaport. In the east, the main idea was to conquer the whole parts of Somalia and to get seaport in Zeila. And he had a good relationship with Italy. And he consolidated his power by using a support from Italy. And this affected the relationship between Minilik and Johannes. By Johannes was on power, Minilik was creating a relationship with Italy, and that makes the relationship between the two individuals very intense. But following the deaths of Johannes, Italia continued to conquer the north part of the country, and Italy expanded towards the central parts of Ethiopia by conquering Bogas, and which is the latter Eritrea, and they continued until Takazi River. And the emperor followed double track diplomacy. That means peace and accumulating of weapons to contain the rivers, or to contain or reverse Italy's expansion in the central parts of the country. However, the emperor's diplomacy endeavor with Italy failed to result in a peace due to Italy's misinterpretations of the controversial Article 70, which is the Ucciali Treaty. They put different versions of Amharic and Italic translation in the treaty, and that resulted the end of the peaceful diplomacy among Italy and Ethiopia. And in 1896, the emperor declared nationwide war against Italy in defense of the territorial integrity of the country. So after the battle, Minilik and his people managed to defeat the colonial power and made a history by defeating the powerful colonial country. So that war victory made many European powers recognize Ethiopia as an independent African state. So after the war, the Italian was defeated, and they accepted Ethiopia as an independent state. Following that, British, France, and Russia, and also Italy, comes to Minilik Palace to arrange formal agreements of ambassadors. Moreover, this power signs formal boundary treaties with the emperor. So after the Adwa, the emperor signed a treaty with these colonial powers, because they were colonizing Kenya, Somalia, Eritrea, Djibouti, and Sudan, the whole neighboring countries, and he put a territorial delimitation among these countries. So as the boundary issue was not settled, there have been disputes and counterclaims with the neighboring country. So after the independence, these countries like Sudan, Somalia, and Eritrea, when they became a country, they created a lot of claims. For example, the Somalis claim Ogaden as their territory, the Eritreans claim Badami as their territory, and the Sudans claim some western parts of the country around Humara as their territory. And this became a big issue even at the present time. And the issue of outlet to the sea remains the main burning question. And we lost the sea after the Italians conquered Eritrea, and it is still the issue of ports, the issue of Assad is the main problem even until now. The fourth emperor we will see is Emperor Haile Selassie. Emperor Haile Selassie takes power in 1930, but Minilik died in the 1913. Between these times, there was Yasu and there was the princess. But in those times, there was not a lot of activity. So we will see Emperor Haile Selassie, and he assumed power in 1913. He was dedicated, that means Haile Selassie was dedicated to the creation of stronger centralized and bureaucratic empire with unquestioned respect by the international community. And this was clear earlier in 1923 when the Haile Selassie, the late Kafari Makone, make the country a member of League of Nations. Also, League of Nations was like an international institution like the present United Nations. It was an international institution established after the First World War. But membership to the League of Nations doesn't help Ethiopia because the Italians annexed Ethiopia in 1936 and they continued their annexation until 1941. And because of that problem, the emperor fled to London and established a government in the exile. And he makes a plea before the League of Nations. When the Italians invaded Ethiopia, he asked the League of Nations to help him. And unfortunately that failed, or the League of Nations failed to help the king. But the king still continued to believe in the ultimate value of effective diplomacy, and he created a strong relationship with the British. And finally, he got a support from them, and with the involvement of the British, the country became free from the Italian invasion. But after the country became free in 1941 with the help of Britain, the British wanted to stay on the country, that means to establish their own rule, or they want to make Ethiopia a colony, or at least the emperor afraid that the British will start that. So to solve that problem, he immediately started a relationship with the United States. By that time, United States was the winners of the Second World War, and it was becoming the world leader in the politics. And by starting the relationship with the US, and also they became willing to help the emperor to strengthen their diplomatic relationship. And the US helped the emperor to get a full control of the country. And in 1952, a United Nations resolution had made possible a federation between Ethiopia and the former colony of Eritrea. So that means the emperor created a very strong international relation of foreign diplomacy within the United Nations, and the United Nations helped the emperor to get Eritrea back with federation. And the federation continued for 10 years. After 10 years, that means in 1962, he incorporated Eritrea fully with Ethiopia. That means he made Eritrea as a province, like those time province of Gojam, Wallaga, or Sidamo. And Eritrea became one of the provinces of the country. And the king moves quickly to firm up relationship with United States. And two agreements were concluded in 1952 to formalize their relationship. As a result, the United Nations guaranteed Ethiopia's security and helped the emperor to have a consolidated political power. With the agreement, US also got a military base in Eritrea. It is called Kanyo military base, and that military base was important for the US to control the surrounding Red Sea and the Arab countries. So the US provide training for Ethiopian forces, that means military force, and by 1975, the total US military assistance to Ethiopia amounted to be more than $280 million. And that is a very big amount of money by that time, even more than the budgets of the country. So in addition, between 1956 and 1976, 3,970 Ethiopian soldiers were trained in the United States. It is also a very big number. It also provides counter-insurgency training, and a ground advisor to help the suppressed Eritrean nationalism. By that time, when the Eritrea became a province with Ethiopia, there was a lot of problem. Some of the Eritreans doesn't want to be a province. So that created a struggle, and the US was the main supporting force for the emperor. Ethiopia also, by the times of the emperor, Ethiopia also played a main role in the independence of Africa. So that means the foreign policy of the emperor is to help the African countries to get their independence and to end colonialism and apartheid. So those policies played a lot of role, and the emperor can be considered as one of the founding fathers of the African unification. The present African Union, which is found in Addis Ababa, and it was mainly became a reality with the help of the emperor. And the establishment of the Organizations of African Union in Addis Ababa witnessed the prominent roles of the emperor in African affairs. He was a very strong participant. Ethiopia has also played a significant role in maintaining international peace and security. We participated in the Korean War, in Congo War, by sending a peacekeeper, and this shows active participations of the emperor. In general, a strong alignment with US and Britain helped the emperor to stay power in decades and solve the issue of port by taking back Eritrea. So the emperor able to become a strong political power in the country, and he also able to get back the ports of the country, which is Mizuwa, Aser, and other ports. The fifth we will see is the foreign policy during the military regime, that means the DERG. And the military regime takes power in 1972, adopted a foreign policy largely oriented to socialist ideology. So here we see the difference. The emperor was an ideology that was largely attached to the United States of America, which is more attached to capitalism. And here, the DERG is inclined to socialist ideology. And the primary objectives of foreign policy was survival of the region and maintaining territorial integrity of the country. In here, the foreign policy of all the regimes are the same. By the times of Theodros, Yohannes, Minilik, Haile Selassie, even in the times of the DERG, the main goals of the foreign policy was survival and territorial integrity. There was always a power which wants to affect or entrench the territorial integrities of the country. But in here, the strategy is different. By the times of the DERG, even if the goal is the same, the strategy was different. The major strategy to achieve the stated goal is based on building military capability of the country and making friendship and alliance with socialist countries of the world. And these socialist countries were taken by the DERG as the viable strategy to keep the territorial integrity and to keep the survival of the region. So it started relationship with, it is really, so but that makes the relationship between the US and the Western countries to become very low. And that because they became the critics of the region, the US and the other Western countries said the dark region is military and it is not good for the country. So that shift it is relationship with the other countries. That means mainly the relationship was with Russia and other countries. And by the times of the dark, internally, there was a clear military or liberation front launched a military attack on the Ethiopian army, and later Somali also started invading in the Ogaden. So Eritreans in the north started to become a liberal, that means to start a free country, or they started a liberation front. In the east, the Somalians started invading Ogaden. And many external actors were involved in sponsoring these rebel groups. That means the Eritreans and also the Somalians. Saudi Arabia, Egypt, Sudan, Somalia, and later the USA, all this was helping the Eritrea Liberation Front. So as you see, Saudi Arabia, Egypt, and Sudan, and Somalia, they are just the sustainer, the main problems, even in the times of Theodros, Minilik, Haile Selassie, in all time, especially Egypt is the main problems for the country. By the times of Haile Selassie, whereas USA was the main partner, but in the times of Dirk, USA became the main against force or supporting the other party, and they became the main problem for the Dirk. So the regime managed to resolve the Somali aggression with the help of Russia. So now the Dirk shifts its attention to Russia. They got support from them and helped to solve the Somalia's invasions of the Ogaden. So the cornerstones of Ethiopian foreign policy at the time was maintaining continued friendship with Soviet Union and other socialist countries. So the main policy, foreign policy, is maintaining a relationship with the Soviet Union. And to maintain that relationship, the Dirk has signed numerous economic, social, political, trade, cultural, education, consular, and administrative agreements, as well as protocols with almost all socialist countries. Those agreements, the bill, those agreements are the main tool to maintain the relationship with socialist countries. And the Dirk has sent hundreds of Ethiopians for training to the Soviet Union, Eastern Europe, Cuba, and also the German Democratic Republic. As you see, in the times of Haile Selassie, the soldiers were or used to be trained in the USA. USA was the main power training the troops of Haile Selassie. But by the times of Dirk, the Soviet Union became the main power that helped the Dirk to train its soldiers. That means a total shift in the strategy. And Ethiopia's strategic location and other questions such as Eritrea and Somalia and the issue of Nile had also shaped the foreign policy and Russia's interest in the region. By that time, Eritrea was part of Ethiopia. That makes the country a strategic point to access for the Red Sea, and that affects the country's importance. So USA changed its support from Ethiopia to Somalia, and Russia changed its support from Somalia to Ethiopia. That means both powers changed their relationship. And Sudan also was one of the host countries for Ethiopian opposition forces, which are supported by Egypt too. In the other way, Egypt, in addition to USA, Sudan and Egypt also supporting forces that are against the Dirk. And in that term, Ethiopia had been supported the dissent groups in South Sudan. against Sudan. So when Sudan supports forces against Ethiopia, Ethiopia also started to support the South Sudan. That was groups that were fighting for the independence of South Sudan. So with regard to Africa, we said Haile Selassie played a main role for the establishment of the African Union in Addis Ababa. Derg also played a lot of role in the decolonization and anti-apartheid struggle. And Ethiopia helped military and technical support to freedom fighters in Angola, in Rhodesia, that means the present-day Zimbabwe and Zambia. The Derg helped militarily for the independence of Africa. That in this issue, Haile Selassie and Derg are the same. The regime had also showed its solidarity to Palestinian cause by condemning Israel. So in the times of Haile Selassie, Haile Selassie was the main supporting Israel, but when Derg comes, Derg started supporting Palestine against Israel. So finally, the regime collapsed following the Cold War, unable to